My name is Aspen Hopkins, and today I will be talking to you about generalizable patterns for humans and machine learning models. I'm a PhD student in Alexander Madry's lab. This is me, but with bangs. And today I want to talk to you about a really big question in the world of machine learning, which is, are models learning something meaningful, causal about the world? Or are they just memorizing data and then regurgitating it? So before we get into the nitty-gritties of this question, I want to talk about the ways that humans build so-called mental models or representations or abstractions to make meaning of the world. Because it turns out this is a really cool thing. We take noisy input, like paws and a tail and ears and the sound of bark and the smell of a creature, and we're somehow able to make a prediction. It's a dog! Oh my gosh, this is so cool. Because dogs don't really always look like dogs, right? There's a lot of variability, and they certainly might not smell alike. I have smelled some nice dogs, and I have smelled some things that rolled in something dead. So neuroscience tries to assign metrics to brain activity to specific representations of the outer world. For instance, a flower can be represented by a single neuron or cell, or it could be many cells working together in the ventral visual stream, which we maybe heard about earlier today. These representations can also go beyond that, building on associations of activities across many regions of the brain to make this representation that helps you operate in the world as you do. So they can occur across many scales and are built using things like the strength of connections, or how much importance is given, and by proximity. So neural elements derive their functionality by how they're connected, the connective fingerprint of each element, and by how they contribute to the system as a whole. And this is really cool because people can take representations and imagine things like this. A dog in an apparently impossible situation playing poker and maybe helping his friend cheat. So there's something really cool going on though, which is that now this is actually from DALL-E, I apologize. But now we have these generative models, and they're able to produce something similar. And it brings up this question, is this just memorization? And this matters a lot, because if models are only learning to memorize input data, so the reason why we saw those images of dogs playing poker is because previously there were images of dogs playing poker, is that in cases where the input data is, for example, your code on GitHub, you might see the model vomit out something someone else wrote. And that's probably not great, because hello, copyright laws. Equally important, if the model is just memorizing input data, it might not have a concept of what a horse is. I mean, I don't know if I would necessarily call that a horse, but it is. And so if the first image is correctly predicted, we would hope that the second and third might also be correctly predicted. But the question of robustness, so does this model have a representation that consistently means what we want it to mean, implies that we hope that models in critical contexts like healthcare are reliable and have these meaningful representations. Similarly, we would hope that a model might classify these seagulls as different species because they're actually different species and not because of the presence of a watermark. As a side note, all of the images that you've seen in here were actually produced with a generative model, with the exception of some people's faces, like mine. So how do we know if it's just memorization? Well, let's talk about how models learn to figure that out. So there's an input, such as an image, which is broken into individual features like pixels. And this is what each hidden layer, that's the middle thing in the middle, right there, the activation function that you see described. That's what these are doing. It takes input from the prior layer, it learns a weight to say how important this feature is, and then it finally uses something called an activation function to decide what the bar is for this neuron to fire. And that's pretty cool. And so in this context, it gives us an output, and it happens to be zero, which is correct. So as the model is presented with different data, different examples of zero, for instance, it updates the importance that it gives each feature of the input. And this is repeated over and over again, with the model updating its weights until it seems to get a relatively high accuracy, what we call converging. In this process, it is learning an internal representation of zero. So you might have these internal representations that are learned by a model, but we don't, as computer scientists, necessarily know what the semantic meaning of those representations are. We might have some hypotheses. For example, I think in a computer vision context, maybe there's a feature, like there's a meaningful representation of a pug nose, and I would hope that whenever this is activated that we see the pug noses in the picture. But what we're focusing on today is something a little bit closer to language models. So in this case, we might expect that the meaningful representation is whether the sentence is long or short. As you know, machine learning suffers from being a black box. We don't always know why an output is given. However, a couple years ago, there was something called probing, which was introduced for natural language models. So the idea behind probing is you have these internal representations that we just talked about, and we can learn what these internal representations are related to, so we can classify them. If there's something meaningful, then we expect that this probe classifier is going to have high accuracy because there's a semantically meaningful expectation, and this lends itself towards the thing that we expect. So this is obviously a fairly poor simplification. If you're curious about this work, there's a bunch of YouTube videos to explore how it works and what it means. But one of the main challenges with probing is that we don't know if what we're finding is actually a causal representation. Does the model actually use the information discovered by a probe? In really big, complex models, this is super hard. Looking for a meaningful representation in foundational models is a little bit like looking for a needle in the haystack. So instead, to build methods for understanding complex models, we sometimes look at smaller worlds, these constrained applications like chess or numerosity. So numerosity is looking at like how many items there are in an input. And this gets me to the paper that I wanted to talk about today, which was published by my amazing collaborators and I, where we look at Othello. This is a game also known as Reversi. Just briefly, the rules of Othello go, you have some initial placements. I'm black, you're white. You sandwich the opposite color between two of yours, flipping that color to your side. And within 64 moves, someone will take over the board so that there are no more sandwiches to be made. Now what we did is we learned a model on sequences of Othello moves to predict the next legal move. It does it really well, that's super exciting. That wasn't the point of our interest. What we cared about was the internal representations. So what we did was we learned probes on these internal representations to see if we can find some causality. We wanted to find if there were internal representation that matched not the sequences of moves, but rather the actual underlying board state. And we were able to. Going beyond this, we were able to use these representations that we found through probing to take a model's layer activations to reflect a different board, and then see the model actually understand what this new board state required. So just to walk you through this, I think this might be a little bit of a confusing graph. On the lower portion of the chart, we see this world state. So this is what the actual board looks like. And if you see and highlighted in like this teal color, there's a white piece. Now what we do is, in the above prediction, this is what the model thinks is the correct next set of moves. What we do is, through this intervention that I was talking about, and through the probing work that we do, we're able to change it so that the model instead thinks that the world state looks like this. Instead, there's a black piece where there was once a white. And now the prediction of the model also changes. Now this is really cool because it means that we have found something that is causal in the internal representations of the model. So how do we do this? Well, remember when we talked about how in the brain some representations happen across multiple regions and multiple scales? We similarly have to intervene across multiple layers of that really simple neural net that I showed you earlier. So we say neuron X is important to this representation. Let's change it. Let's modify it. Going up, we do this again in the next layer, and again, until this prediction is changed, and we can do really interesting things with this information. We can make latent saliency maps to understand the attributions of different neurons and how they relate to that internal representation we were talking about. And we can also look at the representations in general and see, you know, is there something more important being found? So the big takeaway from this is that looking at representations at a local and network level is critical for understanding models, both human and machine learning models, and how they operate in the world. And this is the only way, this is only like a tiny piece of what we have to work towards building deployable models that are robust and understandable. For example, we talked about how the computational complexity of these really large foundational models makes it hard to find internal representations. But we can do other things like approximate it. We can look at out-of-distribution methods, and so maybe we figure out, well, that example of the horse, that doesn't really look like a horse, but we expect the model to do well on, it isn't doing well, so let's add it to the data set. Or let's do other things downstream to make it a little easier for the model to perform the way that we expect. Similarly, we can also look at more complex worlds, more complex tasks. We can look at music embeddings, we can look at protein modeling, and, you know, we can look at protein building. And we can also look at things like 3D Tetris rules and learn how physics is learned by a model. So there's a lot of really interesting work to be done here, and I'm excited to see what the space of future research regarding like generative models and their learned representations implies and how it informs how we actually understand the world. I think it's a very recurrent process. Thank you.
Thank you, Aspen.